Hello, and welcome back to Bitwig featuring the grid. Today's modular concept is phase. Here in this patch, we're looking at the three typical descriptors of sound: pitch, timbre, and loudness, with each of them moving over time, which in most sound design is what makes things interesting, that sense of motion. Now, if there was no motion, we still have all three elements. Loudness is occurring for each note played very quickly, but timbre is set, pitch is set, everything is there, but it's a lot more interesting when these things are moving over time. So that timing element is essentially phase in this case, or I would think of it as the fourth descriptor of sound. Because if nothing is moving over time, then sound design tends to feel pretty flat. So phase, when you are the DAW, such as Bitwig, is an interesting phenomenon. Here is a very common way of thinking of it. What we're seeing here in purple is the phase signal going over time. It goes from 0 to approximately 1, and the default value here is 1 bar. Out of the box, that is how Bitwig is thinking, that everything should sync to 1 bar length. Now, you see the yellow ticks down below, which are basically recreating what we're hearing with the metronome, more or less, with some accents. This is often how systems think about phase and timing. So if I were to go ahead and drop in, let's say, a step sequencer, and then add, from the phase category, a phase counter, this would let us work with signals in the traditional way that many hardware sequencers and other sequencers think about step sequencing. Now, each successive trigger signal is, because of the phase counter, turning into a stepped phase signal to give the same relative output. Now, Bitwig uses phase because it's a lot more accurate and we can produce the signal on its own, and there are some other interesting benefits. But if we wanted to think in that traditional event-oriented model, then we could always go through phase counter and ask for individual triggers to always take us to the next step, or whichever step we're interested in. So I'm going to go ahead and delete these modules, and once I hit play in the transport, you'll notice magically our steps sequencer is already moving, and that is the nature of what we've looked at before, this pre-chord, which is representing a connection from the device phase signal itself straight into the module. So instead of having to wire this every time, I could simply turn that phase knob on. It's on by default, so all the step sequencers are moving, and this phase signal is wired in. Now, if I were to go ahead and duplicate this sequencer, I've got two copies now, so maybe some of these other phase elements we can use to look at how we can process phase signals in a unique way. So starting with this raw signal as it is, the simplest thing possible would be to take the phase reverse device and drop it in. And now you're seeing our two step sequencers with exactly the same data are simply being read in the opposite pattern. So they are never on the same step at the same time. They're actually moving backwards as they go in each case. Another way to look at this, we could try the phase shift module. So now, again, they're lined up by default, but if we change the shift amount to, say, 50%, now we are always half the distance away. We are always starting halfway through the cycle. Now, one thing that makes phase interesting compared to the event-driven model we were talking about, where it's trigger signals, is if we were to change the step count of the second sequencer, you'll notice that it's still the halfway point that we hit at the very beginning, and vice versa, the beginning we hit at the halfway point of the other step sequencer. They are always 50% off, regardless of the step length. So I didn't have to change the timing of anything. It's just using that phase signal as a useful relative indicator of where we should be. Now, in addition to that, what we could do is throw in a phase reset module. So back at our default step count, what the phase reset module does is it lets us say every time a note comes in, you can see the indicator here, it's actually moving the position to reset and re-trigger from the beginning. So all of our step sequence are still perfectly operating in the same time, but when they're starting is changing based on when new notes come in again, because of this pre-chord here that happens to normal in the reset signal. We could have the reset signal coming from somewhere else if we wanted to as well. But seeing all of this is a little bit more helpful with a sound making patch. So let's go ahead and clean some of this up. I've taken this from one of the presets in Bitwig. So the step sequencer here is driving the cutoff of the filter, which is starting relatively low, and these values are mostly low, so then it's only occasionally opening up. If I had this coming the phase reset version, so each note triggered, you can get that feeling of things changing over time and creating an interesting pattern out of what's here. Now, if we were to go ahead and do a couple things. One, let's take this device phase setting, which is indeed determining the global phase speed that's being used. And I were to change it to be twice as quick. Now I only want it to last for 8/16th notes. So now we are happening twice as fast. And what might be interesting is taking this from a monophonic patch to a polyphonic patch. So now, being able to play more than one note at a time makes this phase reset module particularly interesting. So you can see visually within the sequencer itself where all of these individual playheads are moving at the time for reference, and that can be quite interesting. Now, phase signal is going from 0 to 1, so let's take a look at that for one moment. If I were to throw in, let's just get rid of the reset, and use a value knob. So now, as long as the note is playing, I can see it. This is really just setting the position that the lookup is doing. So when I advance from 0, from the beginning, to about 12.5%, we move on to the second step because there are 8 pieces here. If I move just over 50, I'm now at the halfway point at the 5th step. Move towards the end, I've reached the last step. And again, 0 to almost 1 means when I get to 1, it actually goes back to 0. Now, why is that? If I take a constant module instead of a value, and I can do bigger numbers, now what you'll see is, regardless of how big the value is, it's just taking the decimal portion of it and letting us wrap that signal. So even if we did some nasty math and weren't completely clean about it, it's going to keep everything in alignment. And even if this went negative, it's essentially just a modulo function. It's trimming off the integer part and using the rest as the lookup, proportionate to whatever the size of this is. So that's all we're doing. We're just taking a signal from 0 to 1. So let's think outside of the box for a minute. We could potentially use something else as a phase signal. For example, our trusty LFO. If we were to take him, by default, he is supplying a unipolar value, because the bipolar option is turned off. He's going from 0 to 1. So if I play a note, I'm suddenly seeing this exact triangle shape going back and forth within the step sequencer. I could even fake this to be exactly like our phase signal. And you can see they're practically aligned, if maybe perfectly. So now these two signals are going together at the same rate. I've basically faked a phase signal, which works pretty well because I can set metronome values here as well. And with each note resetting, because of this pre-chord, I get the same nice effect of things going over time. Now, what's interesting is having different shapes in the LFO. It can be fun in a whole lot of arenas, but it's uniquely interesting in phase. And what becomes additionally interesting is we can switch to some very non-traditional wave shapes. I like this one in particular. again, it's spending just a very small amount of time on this most open version with the filter, so most of the signal is being removed, which makes it have some breath. Even if I'm holding notes down, there is a rhythmic pattern, almost like I'm triggering different notes over time. Which is interesting in and of itself. Now, let's throw in the twist. If we took this just a little bit further and said, we are working with polyphony. Each copy of the LFO signal is triggering each voice independently. What other note information could I use to make this interesting? Maybe if I take a scalar and say, I would like each version of this phase signal that is driving the step sequencer to be set relative to the velocity of each note that is being played. Now, when I play a soft note, they move a small distance within the step sequencer. And if I were to play with a harder velocity, I get something more interesting going on. So, phase is simply telling me the position of whatever I'm dealing with. In this case, it is immeasurably useful for setting timing and for letting us create interesting organic patterns over time. So, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you again soon.